This is Maria.
And this is Esther.
And together we are
the Consort Counselors.
In this episode, we would like to give you some info for when you start playing on Renaissance concert instruments. Because this is a very exciting moment for every recorder player.
At the same time, this video is an invitation. If you have an ensemble and you are interested in the music of the 15th and the 16th century, to maybe consider getting yourselves some of these recorders.
The first reference to sets of recorders, probably meant to be played together, come from the 15th century. And in the first decades of the 16th century, we find the first detailed description and images of Renaissance recorder concerts, the first instruction books, and the earliest surviving instruments.
Throughout the 16th century, we find some professional musicians playing the recorder in concert as well. Many of them were associated either with a city or they were at the service of a church. For example, in Spain, most cathedrals during the 16th century appointed groups of wind players, and recorders were some of the instruments that these musicians played. And also in Italy and in Flanders, we know of town musicians, groups of wind instrumentalists who played the recorder among other instruments.
However, like today, the largest amount of recorder players in the 16th century were amateur players. The most famous example is King Henry VIII, who collected up to 76 recorders during his lifetime. Can you imagine your country leaders being such fervent recorder players? Henry also wanted to hear the recorders being played at a very high level. So he summoned 5 excellent recorder players and also recorder makers. They were the Bassano brothers from Venice. And like this, he established a court recorder concert that remained active until 1630.
If you like to see a very inspiring collection of original 16th century recorders, and not only that, but also the cases in which they were transported, you can visit the Kunsthistorisches Museum in Vienna. There were also many other great recorder makers in the Renaissance. The Raffi family from Lyon in France, from southern Germany, the family Schnitzer, and the family Rauch von Schrattenbach.
The Rauchs built some very special instruments, including the tallest original recorder known to date.
Here we have a Baroque / modern recorder, and here we have a Renaissance alto recorder in G. Let's compare them and see what are the main differences between the two.
Originally, these instruments were made in one piece as much as possible,
while the typical Baroque recorder was already made in 3 different pieces.
The holes are rather big and rather straight underneath each other.
As you can see, the holes on a Baroque recorder are way smaller.
And there are no double holes for chromatic ease.
On a Baroque-inspired recorder, you do have these double holes. Although in the Baroque period, very few recorders had double holes, this has become a standard in the modern times because we do like chromatics to be easy.
Although you see 2 holes for the lowest note of this instrument. This was because people could choose to play with either their left hand or their right hand down. And the same principle you can see with the key for the lowest note of a bassette. People could choose to play either with their right hand down or with their left hand down.
Ooh. As you can see, this instrument has only 1 key for the lowest pitch of the instrument. That was the standard back in the days. Only very special instruments would have more than 1 key. While nowadays, all our basses and bigger have certainly more keys than that.
Curious to see where the key actually is, then we have to lift this fontanelle and there we see the key work. The fontanelle is here for decoration and also for protection. These little holes are here to let the air come out when the key is open. Because if they would not be there, the pitch would be influenced, and this is what we don't want. What is a real speciality of this instrument is that they are built as a family. They really belong together and they also sound the best together.
Nowadays, we are used to recorders being tuned in C or in F. But in the 15th and 16th century, recorders were usually tuned a fifth apart. So here we have a bass in F, a tenor in C, and an alto in G. If you want to really get into it, you should consider learning G alto fingerings and playing on a set tuned in fifths.
Then a few words about the internal bore of the instruments. Baroque instruments are conical. And you see this, the hole in the bottom is quite narrow.
However, most Renaissance recorders have a internal bore that is first sort of cylindrical, then it gets a little bit narrow, and towards the last finger hole, which is here, it expands, you see? And you can also see that the end here is broader, although the recorder is shorter. This type of shape is not the only one that was common on recorders of the Renaissance. There were also other types, and therefore other types of sound and other types of range.
Philip Bolton made a really nice page on his website where you can see the different shapes of the internal bore of the instruments very clearly. Check it out. The internal bore, of course, influences the sound of the instrument, but also the range of the instrument. The Renaissance recorders we show you today have a range of an octave and a sixth, which is similar to the range of the human voice.
Not very surprising if you remember that actually a great part of the repertoire of early consorts was vocal music performed on instruments.
When you start playing these instruments, the biggest issue is that the ninth tone of the instrument, for example, the middle D on a C instrument, is played with absolutely no fingers. This means you have to watch your stability and your position very well. You can practice letting the instrument rest on your right thumb and also your lower lip and talk in the instrument like this so that you have absolute stability. Sometimes you can use one of the fingers of the right hand to support the instrument a little bit, but you have to be really careful and check if you don't cover any extra hole so that the pitch is influenced. The advantage is, if you can do this very well, your posture and your stability will improve like crazy.
Because of the open fingering, in which no fingers are in contact with the instruments, coming back to, for example, play the high E after the D feels a little bit scary at first. Practice this kind of tricky combinations a couple of times back and forth to get used to it.
The beauty of these instruments is that the different tones don't sound equal. At all. There is an enormous difference between strong fingerings and weak fingerings. This is connected to the music practice and the music theory of those times, in which some tones are thought to have a harsh color and some a much softer character.
A very good rule in general to find the right pitch and character for each chromatic step is, if you're going to play a sharp, F sharp, G sharp, C sharp, look for a bigger sound because those are harsh leading tones. If you are going to play a flat, B flat, E flat, A flat, then look for a rather soft and delicate sound.
When you practice these new fingerings on these instruments, you will for sure become a handy Andy. Every split millimeter makes a huge difference in the pitch. So that is a very delicate issue. What it all comes down to is that you have to use your ears very, very much, and that you have to find the best sound per instrument and also the best sound to fit within the whole ensemble.
The first time you pick up a Renaissance recorder and you play in it, you may feel that the air flows so easily into the instrument that there is almost no resistance.
Yes, and for this reason, every change in air pressure will be magnified in the sound and also in the pitch. The travel speed of the air should be fast, but the sound should still be warm. One way to practice this is exploring the boundaries of the instrument. We are going to play a couple of notes and we play it with extreme vibrato, and then you notice when the sound is still beautiful or when it's on the edge of even cracking. Then after that, try the opposite. Play as a laser beam with very fast and cold air.
Hopefully, after watching today's video, you will be definitely interested on checking out how it feels to play on some of these Renaissance recorders. If you decide to take the step and try out some instruments, we know a few recorder makers who may be very interesting for you.
If hand-built instruments are too expensive for you, you might also check out the Consort by Muck, which is a cheaper alternative. But if you are patient, the occasion might rise and you might find financial means to buy a hand-built consort.
If you get a handmade consort, remember, this is an investment for life. If you take good care of them, they are going to go for many years and you're going to have a lot of beautiful hours of music making.
For our 30 seconds tip today, we want to recommend two websites where you can find second-hand recorders and also second-hand recorder consorts. Recordersforsale.com and buyrecorders.com.
We also want to pay a little tribute to one of the great masters of construction of Renaissance recorders, who unfortunately passed away recently, the American maker Bob Marvin. His website, which is maintained by Vicente Parrilla, is still online, and in it you can find information about the instruments he used to build, as well as his thoughts about music, which are very interesting. We would also warmly recommend to check out some recordings in which you can hear his instruments. He didn't build a lot of recorders over his lifetime, but the ones he built are very wonderful, so worth checking out. We'll leave you a few suggestions in the video description.
Bye-bye, see you next week!
See you next week! If you like our stuff,
please subscribe to our channel and you will never miss an episode
of the Consort Counselors.